at this briefing on Syria. We're very grateful to the Office of Congressman Ellison for sponsoring this briefing. As many of you know, the House is in the midst of voting at the moment, and so Congressman Ellison is on the floor doing his congressional duty. There, we hope that he will step in and join us at some point soon, in which case what we'll do is we'll pause our comments, give him a chance to speak briefly, and then return to the speakers that are with us this afternoon. I'm Stephen Heydemann. I'm the janitor at Ketcham chair who studies at Smith College, and very, very pleased to have the chance to moderate this panel this afternoon. We're very grateful to Congressman Ellison's office for bringing together a really quite extraordinary group of speakers to do two things. One, to give us all a kind of update on the state of play in what's happening in Syria from a variety of different perspectives, but also to offer some thoughts and ideas about ways in which Congress might be able to contribute effectively and positively to reducing violence that has defined the Syrian conflict since it first broke out more than 5 years ago, and contribute to a successful resolution of the conflict through a political process, a political settlement of the conflict. What I would like to do to get us underway is to very briefly introduce our speakers for the briefing this afternoon, and then make a couple of kind of framing comments myself before turning things over to our speakers. We very much hope that our session this afternoon will be not simply us speaking to you from this quite august table here, but will include opportunities for you to engage with questions and comments of your own on the issues and perspectives that our speakers present. And with that in mind, none of us up here are going to talk very much at the outset of this briefing. We're going to each provide a few key points, a few starting points, a few beginning observations as a way to animate the conversation, and we'll then open things up and engage in the back and forth that I think will really probably be the most productive part of our session this afternoon. And because I'm a moderator, I'm going to take the liberty of offering the first of these very brief starting points as a way to get us launched. I'm going to carefully avoid the subjects of our other speakers, who I will introduce now, and provide a kind of macro-level perspective on where I see things with the conflict. That will be followed by comments from Charles Lister, from the Middle East Institute, and from Hassan, whose affiliation, I'm afraid, Hassan, you're going to have to remind me of.
Associate Fellow with the Tahrir Institute.
Tahrir Institute. I still have in mind your connection to the National.
Yeah, but I'm also a columnist, a weekly columnist.
Weekly columnist at the National. You have bios for our speakers, and I won't repeat them for you now, but what I do want to stress is that in Charles and Hassan, we're fortunate to have with us, I think, the best informed and most insightful analysts of ISIS, Jabhat al-Nusra, the Al-Qaeda affiliate in Syria, that are writing today. And so this is a really wonderful opportunity to benefit from the quite extraordinary work that both have done to understand two of the critical actors in the Syrian conflict. We'll follow their comments with some thoughts from Afra Jahdi. Afra is an extraordinary person, a Syrian activist who has been committed to nonviolence as the appropriate refugees inside of Syria and in refugee camps, to support bottom-up grassroots processes of peace building and civil society development. And I think it's really quite exceptional the commitment that she's shown to advancing those kinds of strategies for putting in place foundations that we hope will make it possible for Syrians, once this very violent phase of the conflict ends, to come together and rebuild Syrian society in a positive and productive way. So we're especially lucky to have you with us this afternoon. What I would like to do, as I said, is offer a very quick take on the broad state of play in the conflict. And what I'd really like to stress is that I think we all need to recognize that the conflict is approaching an important turning point. One that I think has a very significant impact on whether we see progress toward a negotiated settlement of the conflict, toward a reduction of violence in Syria, toward improved humanitarian conditions and even perhaps a political transition, or instead find ourselves confronting another decade of conflict. So what are the elements of that pivot? What makes this such a pivotal moment in the conflict? Well, as I see it, Russia's intervention in the conflict by September succeeded in stabilizing the Assad regime, but it has not produced significant changes in conditions on the battlefield. It has not provided Moscow with the leverage that the White House hoped it would to persuade the Assad regime to engage seriously in the Geneva process. The Geneva negotiations themselves were proposed to prepare for a political transition beginning August 1st. That deadline is looking increasingly doubtful. In fact, the negotiations have achieved little. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that today they're on the verge of collapse. And they are in large part because the regime has continued to target civilians in its military campaigns, continues to deny humanitarian access to besieged communities in Syria, including the community of Tahrir, where it not only prevented a humanitarian convoy from entering, but then bombed the civilians who had assembled to wait for the arrival of that convoy. And what these trends have done, I think, is to call into question many of the assumptions driving the administration's approach in Syria. In particular, its expectation that the Russians would be able to deliver the Assad regime, and its willingness to accept Russia's claims that it is in fact committed to a political rather than military solution of the Syrian conflict. These trends, these regime behaviors that I've described, I think undermine the viability of the Geneva process. They weaken the standing of the Syrian opposition, especially the High Negotiation Committee. And they leave us in the final months of the Obama administration, after almost 4 months of sustained diplomatic effort, with no serious prospect for a negotiated transition, with the Assad regime persuaded that it can win on the battlefield, even though it has proven unable to do so far, with further deterioration of humanitarian conditions on the ground in Syria, with no change in the conditions that are driving radicalization and extremism among armed groups in Syria, and with the reality that whoever takes office as President of the United States in January is most likely to confront a conflict that is even more entrenched and more intractable than what we see unfolding right at the moment. So now the question is, what to do about it? What are the possibilities for Congress to play a role in perhaps preventing the possibility that we will find ourselves in this situation? I'm going to hold off on answering that question now, just call it waiting months after that. But we'll return to it in the course of our briefing this afternoon, and I certainly hope that you will press us on that question when we reach the somewhat pessimistic outline of where I see things at the moment. What I'd like to do now is invite a job listener to sign up to work on and please press talk.
So I want to start with saying that over the past 5 years, we noticed that the Obama administration may have perfected the art of making the perfect moral and practical, not only moral but also practical argument against a decision that he would later take. They present a lot of things, they make the arguments for it, but then later they take a decision as if they forgot what they said before. Two cases in point, and this is a very timely occasion to kind of mention these things. And I want to briefly bring in Fallujah and Iraq to Syria because it's important. It's part of a wider trend that's what's taking place, and the U.S. Involvement in the region is part and parcel of the problem that's taking place. There is a wide, I mean, President Obama said last year, presented a very good case against what a model of the fight against ISIS. He said that the best model that proved effective is the one that involves local forces on the ground, working in tandem with the American Air Force or Air Cover, and he emphasized the role of local forces, and he emphasized that in Sunni areas in Iraq and Syria, the role of Sunni forces is key to defeating ISIS, because you can defeat ISIS tactically, but if you stoke sectarian tension, the people in Mosul or Fallujah or in Raqqa and elsewhere see that the Shia militias or Kurdish militias come into these areas and act as invaders, that will bring people closer to ISIS, not in terms of the people start liking ISIS, but they start psychologically or mentally see ISIS as a defender, as a defender of their areas, if not a custodian, military custodian of their areas. And the tool, this is taking place right now, when there's an offensive in Raqqa led by the Kurdish militias, the YPG. Now, I have to say that the Kurdish militias, they're a wider spectrum of Kurdish forces in Syria. Some of them are part of the Syrian opposition. Some of them they have thousands of fighters stranded in northern Iraq, trained by the President, Masoud Barzani, Kurdistan, the Kurdish regional government in Iraq, and they're prevented, they're blocked from coming to Syria, and they said they will fight ISIS, and they will be part of the Syrian opposition, they will work with the Syrian opposition in Iraq and elsewhere, and there is war, and they will fight ISIS, but the YPG is obviously prevented them from coming to Syria because they will be a challenger kind of rival to their dominance in northeastern Syria. And the U.S. also doesn't want them coming at this moment because that would be disruptive, coming to, move against, would basically pit Kurds against each other. But the perception is very important. The fact that the most famous anti-ISIS organization, activist organization, saying, and I saw the tweet by Charles Lester yesterday, that they said, that there are civilians in Raqqa joining forces with ISIS to fight against the invading Kurdish forces. That's a dangerous trend, especially that it's that the exact same thing is happening in Iraq. When people see Fallujah, there are civilians stranded there, and after many months of siege, you have Iranian-backed militias. We report that the spy master, the famous and notorious spy master of Iran, the famous operative Qasem Soleimani, leading the battle in Fallujah, is creating this perception that these are not the Iraqi forces, these are militias, especially with the rhetoric they come in with. Some people say we need to remove Fallujah like a cancer from Iraq because it has always been a problem for Iran. In fact, Fallujah was also a menace for Saddam Hussein, so it's always a problem for Iraq. With that rhetoric, people see ISIS as a side issue, that there are invaders, there are civilians, there are Sunnis, and that somehow ISIS becomes a very minor issue. And the evidence of that is that today the two major Arabic media outlets led with that. Hayat, for example, London-based a Saudi newspaper, led with the slash, the front page story was Soleimani leads the Iraqi forces in the region. So that's a reminder of the exact same time last year when he led the battle against ISIS in Tikrit, the birthplace of Saddam Hussein, the Sunni stronghold, and so on. So all these, and Arabi as well, another Saudi outfit, Aaron from Dubai, also led with a cartoon that says, that compares like a juxtaposed kind of a cartoon with pictures of ISIS carrying a paper of accusations against a condemned man. And on the other hand, you have the American jets condemning the whole of Raqqa, people of Raqqa, saying terror and war on terror, war on terror. So basically, the perception is that this is not a fight against terrorism, it's a fight against Sunnis in the region. So that's very important, very serious issue that has very important policy implications, because you are not defeating ISIS strategically, you're defeating ISIS tactically. That's very important, I think. There is, obviously, people who want to present the fight against ISIS as working very well, and people who probably privilege appearance of success over success against the organization. The second one is for a short time. Very briefly, I just want to say that the second one is the removal of Bashar Assad. For a long time, Secretary of State John Kerry and President Obama both said that Assad is a magnet to terrorism. They identified and made the case very well that without the removal of Bashar Assad, terrorism is unachievable. And now they are making Bashar Assad, removal of Bashar Assad, side story in the peace talks. And they demand, they tell the Syrian opposition that you should accept this half-baked peace process, and you should accept being bombed half of the time rather than being bombed all the time. These two problems, I think, not only, it's not something I'm advised in, it's not something new I'm like bringing up, it's something that the Obama administration made very well.
Down. Assad regime that continues to besiege dozens of villages, towns, and city districts in Syria, and it is the Assad regime's armed forces and paramilitaries who continue to block UN and Red Cross aid. Since Russia's intervention, it's worth saying, as well as the morale having taken a hit within the moderate opposition, and yes, there is a moderate opposition, and I'm happy to talk about that in the discussion, the moderate opposition has also been comparatively weakened in comparison to more conservative or extremist groups that cooperate with the moderate opposition on the battlefield. This is probably my greatest concern with regards to the medium and long-term future of the conflict in Syria. However, it is worth mentioning that the cessation of hostilities, which did last longer than anyone perhaps expected, did reveal a serious weakness within al-Qaeda's affiliates in Syria, Jabhat al-Nusra, and that their success or their ability to coerce the opposition into accepting their presence on the battlefield, into accepting their influence over populated territory, was dramatically reduced when they no longer had a role in fighting armed conflict on an hour-to-hour basis. Very quickly, you saw protests rising up against al-Qaeda, against Jabhat al-Nusra, the kind of protests we haven't actually seen since 2011. Nonetheless, the key point here is that Jabhat al-Nusra spent a considerable amount of resources in early April convincing the armed opposition that its interests were better served in fighting than in abiding by a cessation of hostilities. By the middle of April, their negotiations had succeeded in fighting back in everyone's priority. Quickly, with regards to humanitarian aid, the fact that, as I said at the beginning, the political process is in a state of standstill, I think this is why you now see the international community, the international Syria support group, focusing so much on trying to get humanitarian aid successfully delivered around Syria. It is, of course, a key opposition demand that unless humanitarian aid and the ending of sieges and several other humanitarian demands, unless they are met, the opposition will not go back to Geneva and resume negotiations. According to current counts, there are roughly 57 sieges underway in Syria, two by the opposition, two by ISIS, and 53 by the Assad regime. That's 93% of sieges in Syria are conducted by the Assad regime's armed forces. That's 377,700 civilians, if you want the full count. One example which Stephen pointed to is the town of Dalaya outside Damascus, being besieged for over 3 years. Horrific conditions inside the land. Finally, the UN and the Red Cross got clearance to deliver aid to the land, 2 weeks ago. Unfortunately, much as they did get clearance from the regime to approach the riot, the regime had insisted on food not being within the aid order. Nonetheless, the convoy reached the outskirts of the town, and then the 4th Mechanized Division, which is actually led by Bashar Assad's brother, Marco, the 4th Mechanized Division blocked the convoy on the town's outskirts, began removing baby medicine, or infant medicine and other child medical care, and then eventually refused entry of any of the convoy into the town. And then, to knock it all off, shelled the town and killed several civilians. This is an everyday event in Syria. The UN and the Red Cross have been doing a good job trying to get humanitarian aid in, but the regime is blocking every attempt. The last thing I'll say, I won't go into policy recommendations, talk about that perhaps in the discussion. But prospects for peace in Syria today, I think, rely on six interrelated factors. Number one, Russia, and how much leverage does it actually have over the Assad regime and its behavior in Syria and its willingness to negotiate? Surely, I don't think it actually has as much as we hope. Second, Iran. How much is Iran actually willing to act in sync with the International Syria Support Group and with the statements that have been